Many of us use tap water all the time. We drink it, cook with it, use it to make baby formula. We trust our tap water. But you won't find that trust in Flint, Michigan, because failure at every level of government allowed lead, a toxic metal, into the water supply. But concerned citizens and scientists were able to turn to chemistry to bring the truth to light to better protect their water and hopefully taps across the country. When Flint started getting its water from the Flint River in 2014, city officials could have tailored the chemistry of that water to prevent it from becoming a problem. They didn't. We won't get into all those details here, but you can read about them in Michael Torres' in-depth report for C&EN. Here's a link to that. Without corrosion-limiting chemicals like orthophosphate, Flint's plumbing lost a protective mineral layer that naturally builds up in its pipes. Once that was gone, the water began attacking the pipes themselves, some of which contained lead, or were just made of lead. The U.S. stopped using lead in plumbing decades ago, but we never got rid of the old stuff. How much lead plumbing is out there? We asked Mark Edwards, one of the key figures in uncovering the Flint water crisis, at a recent press conference.
Anywhere from 3 to 13 million lead pipes. And, you know, that's obviously a wide range. But, you know, no one knows. No one knows the number. And most people don't even know if they have a lead pipe in front of their house because, frankly, the water utility doesn't know. We don't know where these lead pipes are. And now people feel that as long as those lead pipes are there, and they're right, it's a ticking time bomb.
That bomb went off in Flint. Here's Jeff Parks, a research scientist in Mark Edwards' group, telling us what the team found in one sample from Flint resident Leanne Walters' home.
One of her samples was over 13,000 ppb.
That's 13,000 parts per billion, which would be 13 milligrams of lead in 1 liter of water. The Environmental Protection Agency and the Centers for Disease Control both say that no level of lead is safe for children. But EPA also has a so-called action level for lead at 15 ppb. That's nearly 1/1,000th of what Jeff found in Leanne's home. We recently visited Jeff to learn how the team measured lead in Flint's water. Here he is with water from Leanne's house. That rust color you see actually comes from iron pipes. Lead is a lot tougher to detect with your eyes. That's why Jeff uses an instrument called an inductively coupled plasma mass spectrometer, or ICP-MS. The machine sucks up a bit of water and spritzes it into a chamber with a plasma. It rips electrons away from atoms within the sample. The ionized atoms are then separated by what's called a quadrupole mass spectrometer that generates an electric field to sort atoms by how massive they are relative to their charge. Jeff finds lead by looking for one of its signature isotopes, but he usually sees lead at levels much lower than 13,000 parts per billion.
I don't calibrate the instrument that high because we don't see lead that high. I talked to Mark about it, and he said, well, dilute the sample and run it again to see, you know, is it really that high or has something happened to your instrument? And we took, you know, one milliliter of her sample and put 99 milliliters of distilled water and ran it again, and we got 130. And so it was 13,000.
Jeff used the ICP-MS to analyze more than 270 Flint water samples last fall. Although Leanne's house was the worst he saw, Jeff still found that about 10% of the water samples he tested had 27 ppb lead or higher. That's roughly twice the EPA action level. But action level doesn't mean what you probably think it does. The action level comes from what's called the lead and copper rule, which Jeff calls weirdly worded. Mark has some stronger opinions.
The lead and copper is a lousy law to start with, right? So even if you're meeting the law, you get many homes that have over 150, even 1,000 parts per billion lead. That's not illegal, you know, in the existing law. You can have hazardous waste levels of lead coming out of a kindergarten classroom in this country. There's no law. People don't realize there's no maximum amount of lead law that applies to any tap in the United States, anywhere.
A water system meets the lead and copper rule when at least 90% of the households it serves have lead levels below the action level. But that's kind of like saying a city is not on fire, even when 10% of its buildings are burning. So it's a pretty lenient rule, and Flint still broke it. But so have other cities in the past, including our nation's capital. Mark's hoping for stricter laws in the future, but it's up to legislators and regulators to change the rules designed to protect the nation's drinking water. Meanwhile, Virginia Tech researchers and EPA are now helping Flint residents retest the same Flint homes Jeff and the team examined last fall. Both Mark and Jeff believe they're going to see much lower lead levels because the city switched back to less corrosive water and because Flint's doing a much better job of controlling water chemistry. The new data will be posted at flintwaterstudy.org soon, so be sure to keep an eye on that.
The water should get better.
but there are things that cannot be repaired. One Flint doctor estimates that as many as 8,000 children were exposed to lead during this disaster. And remember, America's official stance is that no amount of lead is safe for kids. Something like that makes it hard for people to believe in the safety of their tap water.
Once you've been betrayed in this way, you might never get those people to trust water again, and who can blame them?